हेलो गाइस, वेलकम टू मेड एफ ए एंड टुडे विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट जॉन्डिस। सो फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन दैट कम्स इन आवर माइंड इज व्हाट इज जॉन्डिस, राइट? एंड सो इन लेमन टर्म वी कैन से द येलोइश डिस्कलरेशन ऑफ द स्किन इज कॉल्ड जॉन्डिस। ऑल राइट, सो ओनली स्किन, नो, द टर्म वी यूज हियर इज द टिश्यू। ऑल राइट, सो एनी येलोइश डिस्कलरेशन ऑफ द टिश्यू इज कॉल्ड जॉन्डिस। बट वाई येलो? वट इज द कंपाउंड दैट डिपोजिट इन द टिश्यू दैट मेक्स इट येलो? सो दिस इज बिकॉज ऑफ द डिपोजिशन ऑफ, यस आई नो यू ऑलरेडी नो, bilirubin, right? So deposition of bilirubin makes the tissue yellow, and this the yellowish tissue, discoloration of the tissue is called jaundice. All right, so how can we detect jaundice? Just by looking at the patient. How can we detect just by looking at the patient? So where can we see that tells us immediately that this patient has jaundice? So if there is only slight increase in the jaundice, this is best detected at sclera. All right, sclera. So we will be examining sclera for the icterus. What is icterus? Icterus means yellow sclera. All right, but why? Why at sclera only? Because sclera have an special ability. It has higher affinity for bilirubin. Why? Due to high elastin content. So basically in sclera there is high elastin content, and elastin content is have high affinity for the bilirubin. That's why a slight increase in the bilirubin will come to sclera and it will deposit to the sclera immediately. So we can detect just by looking at the sclera that this patient has jaundice. Where else can we look? The second site is underneath the tongue. All right, underneath the tongue. Now when we look underneath the tongue, we can actually see two colors. One definitely is yellow because of the bilirubin, but also green. Why green? And when we will be seeing green? So if there is long standing jaundice, if the jaundice is long standing, there will be oxidation of bilirubin to biliverdin. And what is the color of biliverdin? It's green. So now you know why we will be seeing green color in the long standing jaundice. All right, now but what actually happens is, just when we look at the patient and the patient's sclera is yellow and tissues are also yellow, what are the differential diagnosis for that? So let's talk about the differential diagnosis of yellow discoloration of the skin. All right, what are the differential diagnosis for the yellow discoloration of the skin? First, as we already talked about, is jaundice. The second is keratinoderma. Third is drugs, and the last one is phenols. Alright, we talked about keratinoderma. What is actually keratinoderma? Keratinoderma is yellow color tissue present in the patient who took excessive amount of vegetable or fruits, but not all vegetables or fruits, only vegetable or fruits that contains what? Carotene. Like, what are the fruits that can contain carotene? Carrots, obviously, leafy vegetable, squash, peaches, oranges have slightly also. All right. So, keratinoderma and jaundice both shows yellowish discoloration of the skin. But how we gonna differentiate them? So, how to differentiate jaundice versus keratinoderma? First of all, they both have yellow colors. But in jaundice, the yellow color is distributed uniformly all our body. Uniformly all over the body. Alright. But in keratinoderma, it is concentrated to palms, soles, forehead and nasolabial folds. Alright. And one most important thing in jaundice, there is yellowish sclera. So icterus will be present, but there will be no icterus in the keratinoderma. And this is the distinguishable feature of jaundice, and that's how we can differentiate between jaundice and keratinoderma. Alright. Let's talk about another predictor. How can we know that this patient has jaundice? Another predictor is also, as you already know, urine. If the patient complains of dark urine, in layman term we can say tea colored urine or cola colored urine, that is because of the renal excretion of conjugated bilirubin. Take note, conjugated bilirubin. Alright, we will talk about what is conjugated and non-conjugated. Now, let's talk about some biochemistry, and let's talk how bilirubin is produced and what is the metabolism of bilirubin. Alright, so bilirubin. Total bilirubin produced in body is 4 mg per kg. It comes from 85% of this comes from 85% of this comes from breakdown of hemoglobin. Alright. And the rest comes from number 1. Premature destroyed erythroid cells. Alright, prematurely destroyed erythroid cells. Where erythroid cells are present? In bone marrow. Alright, and also it comes from the remaining proteins that have hemoglobins in them, like myoglobin and cytochromes. They also contain some amount of heme, and they are found in normal body tissues. Alright. So, how it is formed. How bilirubin is formed? Let's talk about this. So, first of all, there are two organs in the body that can produce bilirubin. What are the two organs? Liver and spleen. These two organs have a specific type of cell that is called reticuloendothelial cells. Alright, so reticuloendothelial cells found in liver and spleen. Hemoglobins have been taken here. Hemoglobin comes here, and with the use of an enzyme, it is converted into biliverdin plus carbon monoxide and iron Fe. And the enzyme that is used is heme oxygenase enzyme. So with the use of heme oxygenase enzyme, hemoglobin is converted into biliverdin and carbon monoxide plus iron. Then this biliverdin will be converted into bilirubin. With the use of enzyme that is called biliverdin reductase. Alright, so we found our bilirubin. But this bilirubin have hydrogen bonds, and hydrogen bonds are powerful. So it is non-soluble. Because to be soluble in the water, the hydrogen bonds must be broken down. But the hydrogen bonds are more powerful than, that's why the bilirubin is non-soluble in water. Now what? Now comes the protein albumin. Alright, albumin. The bilirubin and albumin. Albumin bounds to bilirubin, and then it will be taken into liver. Where in liver? In hepatocytes. The cells presented in the liver is called hepatocytes. Alright. So in the liver, here is our hepatocyte. Now, the important organelles from these cells for us is only two. The one is cytosol, the second one is, this is endoplasmic reticulum. Alright, just ignore all other organelles, just the two are important ones. Alright, so the bilirubin that has been bound to the albumin will be taken here, and then only bilirubin will enter to hepatocyte. Albumin do not enter. Right? So albumin cannot come inside the hepatocyte. So here is our bilirubin that is inside hepatocyte. In this transfer, until now we cannot find any transporters. Alright, now this bilirubin will go from the cytosol, will go to endoplasmic reticulum, and here in the endoplasmic reticulum, the bilirubin will bind to glucuronic acid. With the help of enzyme UDPGT. Alright, with the help of enzyme UDPGT. Now, the product of this is conjugated bilirubin. So the binding of glucuronic acid to bilirubin makes the bilirubin conjugated with the help of enzyme UDPGT. What is UDPGT? Uridine diphosphate glucuronosyl transferase. Alright, uridine diphosphate glucuronosyl transferase, UDPGT. Now, here is our conjugated bilirubin. Still in the cell, alright, still inside the cell, not come outside the hepatocyte, is till now. Now this will come outside in the bile canaliculus with the help of MRP2 transporter. They are actively transporting the conjugated bilirubin into the bile. From here, it goes to second part of the duodenum, then goes to proximal small bowel, then distal ileum, and then colon. All right. In here, in the colon, the conjugated bilirubin will be taken by the bacterial beta glucuronidase and will be converted into unconjugated. Now we have unconjugated bilirubin. Alright. So this enzyme is called bacterial beta glucuronidase. With the help of bacterial beta glucuronidase, conjugated bilirubin is converted into unconjugated bilirubin. Now this unconjugated bilirubin will be reduced by the gut bacteria into urobilinogen, and this urobilinogen will go to feces and will be excreted out from the body. A small portion of this also goes into the renal pathway and excreted via the urine. For it, unconjugated bilirubin will be excreted via the urine, not conjugated. Now here we can tell that increased urinary excretion, listen to me carefully, increased urinary excretion of the unconjugated bilirubin is because of, take note, increased bilirubin production. Okay, so if there is increased bilirubin production, if this will be increased, there will be increase in the unconjugated bilirubin, and this will be taken by the renal system and excreted in the urine. So that will cause increased urinary excretion. Also, increased hepatic reabsorption of the urobilinogen from colon. If urobilinogen is increasingly absorbed from the colon, that will also cause increased urinary excretion, and also decrease hepatic clearance of urobilinogen. If the urobilinogen will not go to hepatic pathway, it will eventually go to renal pathway and then excreted via the urine. Alright. Now let's talk about how we can approach with the patient with jaundice. So now, the most important thing to take note is the history. First of all, ask for the history, drug exposures, what are the medications the patient is taking, and everything else you can ask. Also family history, because some of the diseases are from the family. Travel history you can ask. Hepatitis, because of the hepatitis, there are some endemic regions where hepatitis is more, or any other exposure to hepatitis patient, exposure to jaundice patient, we can also ask. All right. What are the physical examination that we will ask? Obviously, we will go for the scleral examination, urine examination, and also the underneath the tongue and palm and soles, we will check everything if the patient has edema or something. Alright, what are the lab tests that we can go for? The basic lab test that is important here is bilirubin with fractionation. Take note, bilirubin with fractionation, AST, ALT, alkaline phosphatase, and prothrombin time and albumin. Alright, each have their own significance. In the lab test, if we found that there is isolated elevation of the bilirubin, what is isolated elevation of the bilirubin? Either the conjugated bilirubin is elevated or the unconjugated bilirubin is elevated. If there is conjugate, that is called direct bilirubin, if there is direct hyperbilirubinemia, then the cause of direct hyperbilirubinemia is here. What are the cause of direct hyperbilirubinemia? Direct hyperbilirubinemia is caused by inherited conditions like Dubin-Johnson syndrome or Rotor syndrome. Alright, the Dubin-Johnson syndrome and Rotor syndrome directly affect the UDPGT enzyme that help in the conjugation of the glucuronic acid with bilirubin. Alright, now if there is indirect hyperbilirubinemia, that can be because of the drugs like rifampicin or probenecid, the anti-TB drug, inherited disorder like Gilbert syndrome or Kligler-Najjar syndrome, or hemolytic disorder. In the hemolytic disorder, there will be increased destruction of the heme and increased production of the bilirubin, and that so the liver will not be able to conjugate so much of bilirubin, and the rest of the bilirubin will go through the renal system and there will be hyperbilirubinemia. Alright, so what are the causes? Let's see in detail. What are the causes? Hemolytic disorders, ineffective erythropoiesis. Ineffective erythropoiesis, in this there is increased production of RBC, but it's ineffective, so the RBC is not being made, but only erythrocytes are increasing, and they are not fully matured, so they are being cleared out by the body, and there will be increased production of heme and eventually production of the bilirubin also. Alright, so increased bilirubin production is there because of the erythrocyte. Also drugs like rifampicin, probenecid, ribavirin, and protease inhibitors like indinavir can also cause indirect hyperbilirubinemia. Inherited conditions like Kligler-Najjar type 1 and type 2 and Gilbert syndrome can also be a cause of indirect hyperbilirubinemia. Now let's go to this side. If we see that the bilirubin is increased and also the liver tests elevated, if there is liver tests are normal, only elevation of the bilirubin, then we will think about direct or indirect. But if there are also involvement of the renal tests, then we will look for if there is AST ALT elevation. If AST ALT elevation are out of proportion to the alkaline phosphatase, if alkaline phosphatase is not much elevated than the ALT AST, then the causes can be viral, toxicologic, or ceruloplasmic. Alright, but if the alkaline phosphatase is much more higher than the ALT AST, then we will go for ultrasound. Alright, so what are the cause for this is called cholestatic pattern and this is called hepatocellular pattern. So what are the cause of hepatocellular pattern and what are the cause of cholestatic pattern? Here are the cause of hepatocellular conditions. Alright, as I already told you, viral hepatitis, ABCDE, EBV virus, CMV virus, herpes simplex virus can cause hepatocellular conditions. Also alcoholic hepatitis, drug toxicity of isoniazid or acetaminophen, environmental toxins such as vinyl chloride, kava, Wilson's disease, very important, and autoimmune hepatitis can also lead to hepatocellular conditions. In the Wilson disease, there is a ring formed in the eyes that is called Kescher-Fleischer ring. Alright, take note of Wilson's disease because of the deposition of the copper. And what are the cause of cholestatic conditions? Here are the cause of cholestatic condition that we have divided into intrahepatic and extrahepatic. What are the intrahepatics that can cause cholestatic conditions? Cholestatic condition, already I have told you, but let's hear. The alkaline phosphate is increased more than the ALT and AST. So alkaline phosphate is more increased, but it's increased but not than the alkaline phosphatase. Alright, AST ALT is not that increased than the alkaline phosphatase. So the first cause intrahepatic, the first one is viral, alcoholic, drug toxicity, chlorpromazine, alright, and prochlorperazine. Biliary cholangitis can be the cause. Sarcoidosis is an important one. Alright. Cholestasis of pregnancy is an important one. Also, there are many, but the importance are only those. Alright. And in the extrahepatic cause, very important, malignancy. Always rule out malignancy. If there is extrahepatic cause and there is cholestatic condition. Alright, if you found cholestatic conditions, always check for ultrasound, CT scan, because there can be an malignant cancer. The most common malignant cancer there is cholangiocarcinoma, and in the benign condition there can be choledocholithiasis, very normal. Also Meige syndrome is important. Alright, parasite ascariasis can also cause this. Alright, so if there is cholestatic pattern, then we will go for ultrasound so we can rule out the malignancy or any benign condition. Alright. If we found dilated ducts and extrahepatic cholestasis, then we will do MRCP. And if the ducts are not dilated, then we will go for serologic testing for hepatitis A, hepatitis serologies and drugs also. And after that, if it is AMA positive, then we will go for the liver biopsy. Right? What is AMA? Anti-mitochondrial antibodies. And if it is negative, then we will go to MRCP, magnetic resonance cholangiopancreatography. Alright. Now comes to hepatocellular pattern. If there is hepatocellular pattern, AST-ALT is elevated out of proportion to the alkaline phosphatase, then we will check for the viral serologies or toxicologic screen. High acetaminophen level, high paracetamol level can also cause this. And we will also go for ANA, SMA, SPEP. ANA is anti-nuclear antibody. Alright. SMA is smooth muscle antibody. And SPEP is serum protein erythropoiesis. You can check it here also. If the results are still negative, then we will do additional virologic testing for CMV DNA and EBV capsid antigen. Alright, if still negative, then we will do renal biopsy to rule out any kind of malignancy or hidden malignancy. Alright, so this is how you approach to a patient with jaundice. So that's all, folks. The lecture has been taken from the Harrison 20th edition. So if you have any question, any doubt, you can post the comment. Thank you very much.